vehicle for reducing greenhouse gas emissions. We can go to the next one. Just wanted to give you a sense of how we structured the co-op. Now, it's bearing in mind that this is more than two and a half years ago now. So at that point in time, our estimate of what it was going to cost to install a solar panel in the 250, 260 watt range, fully installed with inverters, covering labor costs, and all the other costs that are involved in an installation, we estimated it at around $950. That's not the case today. It's significantly cheaper, but it was the case when we set up. So we made that the preferred share price. We actually contemplated for a little while setting up a co-op model in which people would buy panels rather than buying shares. So our initial thought was to buy panels. But then we decided that we should instead sell shares. And the reason we made that decision is that we realized that the cost of solar panels was going to keep coming down. And we didn't want to disadvantage the early investors in the co-op. So we thought that the way to protect their interest was to sell preferred shares instead. So we set it up with a $50 common share, which is the membership part of the purchase, and a $950 preferred share. So people came in basically at $1,000 as an initial investment. And that's what was required in our case to be a member of the cooperative. After that, you could own as many preferred shares as you like. So we have some members now with 25 or 30 preferred shares, not very many, two or three people. But we have lots of members who have one or two or three or four shares, just depending on their financial circumstances. Everybody gets one vote, whether they have one preferred share or 20 preferred shares, they have one vote. So they're the basic, one of the basic principles of establishing a co-op being one member. And the members have elected a volunteer board of directors that meets on a monthly basis. As it grows bigger, we find we really are running a business. Even though it's not a business that's making a lot of profit in any significant way at this point in time, our hope is that ultimately we're at least going to be able to repay all of our members the money that they put in, and that hopefully they will be able to earn a little bit of money as well. But we're finding that, you know, most of the people, it's like yourselves, people aren't really putting money into the co-op to make money. Most people are putting money in as an ethical investment to try to get solar kick-started in our community in a more significant way. So we're completely volunteer run. We don't have staff, and we can't afford staff. There's just not the margin in solar to be able to, even as you scale up, to be able to afford staff at this point in time, unless we got really big. At this point, we haven't decided to do that. We can go to the next slide. Now, we created a consumer co-op. And this is really bending the consumer co-op model a little bit. What we really need in Saskatchewan is legislation that is specifically geared at renewable power cooperatives. This is more like a producer co-op than it is a consumer co-op. So we had to think about, if we were the only kind of producer co-op you can set up right now is in agriculture in Saskatchewan. And there isn't really provision for a renewable power co-op that easily fits under the co-op app. So we set ourselves up as a consumer co-op, and patronage was defined as the purchase of solar panels, inverters, and other equipment, and people's preferred shares would be used for that purpose. And then patronage dividends, which we have not paid yet, but when we do, they'll be paid on the basis of the net income that comes from the co-op's electrical production and the other services that the co-op offers in terms of green energy services. So we're not just producing electricity, we're also providing a green energy service to our the partners that we have established, and you'll see more about these partnerships in a minute. The notion then is that eventually the co-op will generate income that will allow dividends to be paid, and then depending on how many preferred shares each person has, the dividend will reflect that investment. But you can go on to the next one. Thank you. I just wanted to give you a sense about some of the reasons why we decided to set up a solar power cooperative. One of them is that we, a lot of people are just not in a position to spend $20,000 on their own solar array for their own home. So this lets people come into the co-op basically one share at a time, so they can have what's the equivalent of one or two or three panels that they've invested in. They can get a little bit of a feel for solar and what the costs are. They can take a look at how costs are coming down, because panel costs come down on almost an annual basis. And they get a little bit of a feeling for the acquisition of solar before they get into it in a major way. This also opens the door to people who don't own their own home. So it opens the door to renters and condominium owners coming in. It's hard for a condo right now to get everybody to agree to put up solar panels, but individuals in a condo can come and invest in the co-op. I think one of the really attractive things about the co-op model is that if you move, and a lot of people do, lots of people invest in solar on their home, and 8 or 9 years later they're moving somewhere else. You never lose your investment in the co-op. So you can move around your time in different locations and still own your panels in the cooperative. For people who've got shade issues on their property, and certainly for those of us in the kind of the core neighborhoods in Saskatoon where we've got all these beautiful elm trees, we've also got lots of shade issues. So what the co-op can do is look around for really sunny locations to locate a panel installation. And that's also attractive for some people who just feel they've got too much shade on their own rooftop to really go with solar. We've got a few people who are actually viewing the co-op as part of their strategy for becoming carbon neutral in their own lives. So in some cases they put solar on their own property already, but they're not generating all their electrical needs from their solar panels. So they're investing in our solar co-op so that they can say that they're meeting all of their electricity needs through solar. So they might have 12 panels on their house and and 8 panels in the co-op, so to speak, and that's giving them the electricity they need to move towards carbon neutrality. Looking to see if there's any points that I missed. Important point, these first two items are actually, I think, the second item is important. We're able to, with the investments that we've chosen to make, we haven't done solar in a really big way. Like we haven't built a solar farm or anything like that, as you'll see in a minute. But what we have done is looked around for the sweet spot in rooftop solar. And in Ontario, where they've been doing solar for years, and where they have now, by the way, more than 2,000 megawatts of installed solar, and just to put that in context, our total generating capacity in Saskatchewan right now is about 4,400 megawatts. So Ontario has well over 2,000 megawatts of solar right now. So it's not insignificant. But in Ontario, the provincial government has really facilitated the adoption of solar power. So it adopted what's called a feed-in tariff, and essentially the feed-in tariff assured people back when it was introduced in 2009 that they would be able to get a price for their solar generated electricity that was well above the price that people were paying in Ontario right now. Not that people were going to get rich doing this, but it was going to cover the cost of their solar installation. That's what it was intended to do, and let them make a little bit of money. So, and then the Ontario government gradually brought that feed-in tariff down as the cost of solar came down. Now, what that did is it opened the door to both the establishment of lots of solar farms in Ontario, and it also opened the door to lots of people deciding to do rooftop solar in Ontario. And initially, you know, in just a few years ago, the Ontario government was paying 40 cents a kilowatt hour for solar-generated electricity on rooftops. Now it's more like 18 cents. What's been happening in Saskatchewan is that as the costs of solar panels come down, and as our electricity prices go up, the break-even point for, in terms of residential electricity right now, we're paying about 15 cents a kilowatt hour for our electricity at home. If you look at your electricity bill at home, you'll see you're paying about 15 cents a kilowatt hour. Well, under the net metering program that was established in 2007 in Saskatchewan, you basically get paid for solar generated electricity the same rate at which you pay for electricity. So when you used to be paying 10 cents a kilowatt hour for electricity and solar cost 40, it wasn't attractive. Now you're paying 15 cents for electricity, and you really can install solar for 15 cents. So you're in a break-even position right now. And that's much, much more attractive for those of us who want to make an ethical investment in solar power. So rooftop solar is now, I would say, break-even. The installers will sometimes tell you can make money at it. But you know, you have to build in your insurance costs, your extra insurance costs, the replacement of your inverters, because you'll need to replace your inverters at some point probably. All of these kind of costs need to be considered. They're part of operating your solar system. So I view it as kind of a break-even proposition right now rather than a money-making proposition. But you can recover your capital costs. Your panels are going to last for at least 25 years, possibly 30. You can now easily recover your capital costs over the life of the panels. And I think you can cover your operating costs too, and at the very end you may be able to make a little bit of money on the panels, just depending on how quick the electricity prices go up in Saskatchewan. So for a rooftop system though, the ideal is to be able to scale it up beyond the size of a house rooftop and look for a bigger rooftop where you can get economies of scale from the installation. And that's what we tried to do with the solar co-op. And here's the tricky thing about it. We'll go maybe to the next slide. Here's our first installation. And this is the building that the Saskatchewan Environmental Society rents office space in. It's called the 220 building in Saskatoon on 20th Street West. A few of you may have been in it. It's got a coffee shop on the bottom, Collective Coffee. This is just these. We've got five panels that we made visible on the street because we just wanted people to be able to see that there's solar on the building. But the real production is the next slide, John. The real production is on the roof. This is the panels being installed. And we've got 85 panels on the roof. This is kind of the ideal roof size for solar, given the pricing system for electricity in the province. What happens is that once you get beyond the size of building that the 220 building is in Saskatoon, once you get over about 16,000 kilowatt hours of electricity use per month, electricity prices drop. I don't agree with this, by the way, at all, but that's what happens. So we're paying 15 cents a kilowatt hour at home for our electricity. But a bigger commercial building in Regina or Saskatoon, once they've used that initial block of electricity, so after that first 15 or 16,000 kilowatt hours, they'll drop to about 8 cents a kilowatt hour for their electricity. And then they'll use a whole bunch of electricity in that 8 cents a kilowatt hour range. Well, solar is not attractive at 8 cents a kilowatt hour. That's why all your big commercial buildings in Saskatoon and Regina including the University of Saskatchewan, are not doing much in terms of solar because there's no economics there for them.
And the U of R.
Because they're saving their electricity at the margin. So in other words, when my son is a teacher at Tommy Douglas Collegiate in Saskatoon, and he's kind of the teacher support to the Eco Club there, and the students really wanted to do a solar project, so they have gone ahead. They put 12 panels on the school. It's only meeting a tiny, tiny fraction of the school's electricity, but those panels are saving the school 7.5 cents a kilowatt hour. That's what they're paying for most of their electricity costs. And so they're paying basically half the price that we are at home. Now that's great for the school from the point of view of their cost for power, but it's completely unattractive from the point of view of the economics of solar. If you had a feed-in tariff in Saskatchewan, like they've had in Ontario, and you paid a set rate for solar that was designed to cover costs, Tommy Douglas Collegiate or any other school in the province could start putting up solar, at least at a break-even basis. And they have wonderful rooftops for it, and they could get great economies of scale. But we don't have that. The pricing system for electricity in Saskatchewan makes that really difficult right now. So what we've done in the co-op is we look for the sweet spot, which is the buildings that are just big enough not to get into that range where electricity prices drop. And then we've said to those building owners, we've looked around for ethical building owners who want to green their buildings, and we've said, why don't we create a partnership in which we do the solar installation for you, and you pay us in the neighborhood of what we save you, but not exactly. Because if you can't, you have to be careful. Under the SaskPower Act, you can't actually sell electricity and compete with SaskPower, but you can provide a green service, and you can be compensated for it, and that's what we're doing. So this is the service that we provided to Curtis Olson, who owns this 220 building. We'll give you a couple of other examples of that. This building, by the way, these panels produced 28,388 kilowatt hours of electricity in their first year of operation. Notice the angle of these panels. And this is one of the issues that we've kind of learned as we've gone. We really wanted to do this building because we know Curtis and our offices are there and all of that. But notice that the angle of these panels isn't very steep. Ideally, it would be a 30-degree angle. That was our original plan. When we actually, got an engineer to assess this rooftop, the engineer said you can do solar on it, but you have to keep it at a 10-degree angle. Otherwise, there'll be too much weight on the roof. And we kind of went back and forth on whether to go ahead, and we decided that we would go ahead. And actually, it's been a perfectly good investment. But one of the things you always want to do is get an engineer's stamp on a rooftop before you put panels on it to verify that the rooftop will hold the weight of the panels and the extra snow flow that comes with that and all of this. Of course, at a 10-degree angle, you don't shed snow very easily. That's one of the disadvantages of this particular installation. We get really good summer early fall and spring production from it, and obviously less than ideal conditions. So just go on to the next slide. And this gives you a sense about that 28,388 kilowatt hours of electricity saved 16.6 tons of greenhouse gas emissions. So it's a pretty modest first start. It gives you about the electricity that would maybe be provided for three homes of Regina or Saskatoon, roughly speaking. So it was a good first project, and we learned lots doing it. One of the things we learned is kind of the key elements to put into a request for proposal. And I'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute, because we wanted solar installers to compete for the installation, and we were obviously not just looking for the best price, but also looking for a good quality product. You had a question, sir.
How many square feet is the building?
You know, John, just offhand, I don't recall how many square feet it is, I'm sorry.
So we've got 85, so 90 panels all total with the sunroom.
That's right, yeah, 90 panels on the rooftop. We didn't cover the entire rooftop, but we covered most of it.
Two-story building?
Two-story building, yeah. All offices, except for the coffee shop downstairs. So it's office space, meeting room space, mostly either not-for-profit groups or small businesses. There's about, there's over 100 people working in the building, actually, so it's got, you know, it's got lots of little offices, including a lot of basement space. The second installation we did was actually with our municipal utility. We're fortunate, there's only two municipal utilities in Saskatchewan. One is in Swift Current and the other is in Saskatoon. That utility existed before SaskPower was set up. And essentially it was grandfathered into the electrical generating system in the province, as was the one in Swift Current. But it creates an interesting situation because we've got actually a really close working relationship with our local municipal utility. And it was very interested in supporting our co-op. So we planned a solar demonstration site together at what's called the landfill gas generating station in Saskatoon. In the background, that white building is the landfill gas generating station in Saskatoon, and it's located near the landfill. Methane is being sucked out of the landfill, and that methane is then just being used by this generating station to produce electricity, so it isn't being burned. And then instead of the methane gradually seeping out of the landfill as a potent greenhouse gas, instead the landfill gas generating station is using it as a fuel, and it's carbon dioxide that's being released into the atmosphere instead of methane. So that's much the methane would be much more potent greenhouse gas. So it's a good project, and we like the idea of one clean energy project supporting another. So what we're doing, the landfill gas generating station has electrical needs at home, and this solar installation is providing about 40% of those electrical needs. So it's got computers, and it's got lighting, and it's got pumps working and things like that, and a lot of that is now being operated. And what the city did is we essentially partnered on the project with the city of Saskatoon, specifically the Saskatoon Light and Power. We invested in 90 panels of the site. Our co-op owns 40 of those panels. The interesting thing about this site, first of all, it's ground mount, as you can see. The panels are all on the ground. So there's not that many ground mount sites in Saskatoon. This is one of them. There's also one at the University of Saskatchewan. Most of them are rooftops, so it gives people a sense of what a ground mount installation could look like. It was a little more costly to do. You can see there's a lot more infrastructure here supporting the panels than there was in the earlier rooftop shop that you saw. So this was a bit more expensive. It's an interesting project in the sense that it is a real demonstration site. People can come and tour it. And it also, it's helped give our co-op a little bit of profile. The panels are a lot more visible than the rooftop panels that we invested in earlier. The Saskatoon Light and Power has been a really good partner. They shared the net metering grant that they got from SaskPower with us when they did this installation. They've been really good to work with. There's data being kept on these panels on a daily basis, and there's a mix of panels on the site. We can maybe go to the next slide, John. Of our 40 panels, 20 are fixed at a 45 degree angle, and 20 are what are called seasonally adjusted. So we adjust them four times a year. Here you see our co-op board being joined by the mayor of Saskatoon, Charlie Clark, and some of the Saskatoon Light and Power officials. And we're actually standing in front of some of the seasonally adjusted panels on the site, which in the wintertime when the shot was taken, we're at a 60-degree angle. So they're at a 30-degree angle in the summer, a 45-degree angle in the spring and fall, and a 60-degree angle in the winter. That's working really well in terms of keeping snow off these panels in the winter. We find at about 55 degrees you can keep snow off your panels pretty well all winter long. So that's a very nice advantage. We can go to the next slide, Josh. So that's been a good project for us. And by the way, on that site, we don't own this, but SIA invested in 12 tractor panels on that site. So the city owns 40 panels, our solar co-op owns 40 panels, and the and SIA owns 12 panels, and those 12 panels actually track the sun as it moves through the sky throughout the day. There's more risk of breakdown with those panels because there's a lot of moving parts. This is one of the reasons we decided not to invest in them. But they certainly great from the point of view of the solar demonstration program. This is our third installation. It's located out fairly close to the airport in Saskatoon. Not quite all the way to the airport, but about a mile away. So it's in the north industrial area of Saskatoon. And we installed 80 solar panels on the rooftop of this space. We made a decision to, the building owner again here, we looked around for a very, we were looking for good partners. And one of the things that I really recommend if you decide to form a solar cooperative and you're investing on other people's buildings, is that you look around very carefully for good partners. So people who are ethically committed to, greening their building, people who you're going to want to have a 25, 30 year relationship with. You're going to be signing long-term agreements. We're signing legal agreements for 25 years with the building owner. So you want to have people that you're really comfortable working with. And everything can't be guaranteed, of course, into the future, but it's very nice to have a strong working relationship with a partner. So in this case, installation went up with Montgomery Agencies, whose owners have got a really good record in Saskatoon in terms of supporting the Saskatchewan Environmental Society and supporting green causes and wanting to do this, for the right reasons. So they strengthened their roof, they so that it could hold solar panels at a 25-degree angle, and we've installed them at a 25-degree angle here. So you can see these panels will probably be will produce a lot better than the ones that the 220 building, but particularly during the fall and the spring and winter period. We can maybe move on to the next slide. This is one of the interesting things about this site is that there's four commercial tenants in the building, and there are very few net metering projects in the province that involve multiple users of the building. So one of the complicating things about this project, but it's also important to kind of cut this new ground, is that we wanted to model for the north end of Saskatoon, because there's hundreds of rooftops in the north end of Saskatoon like this. We wanted to demonstrate that this is economically viable. We wanted to encourage other commercial building owners to do the same thing. We also wanted to model multiple tenants in a building. And that has been complicated because SaskPower needs to have a net metering agreement with every tenant. And every tenant needs to sign off on that net metering agreement. There's more administrative work to do. And you need to kind of get the tenants all on side as well as the building owner.
How does that work with a condo board? Is it just one condo board, or do all the owners have to sign off on a net metering?
It depends on how the electricity is being used by the condo. Say it was all being used in commonly held facilities, in maybe a multi-purpose room and a little gym in the space and those kind of things. then it could just be signed off on by the condo board. But I think, and we need to ask Sass Parra about this to be certain, but I suspect that the individual building owners, the individual condo owners would need to sign off on a project that involved them being supplied electricity in their own units. So I think you'd net meter, you'd end up net metering each condo customer. Which of course makes it complicated, right?
Yeah. Maybe too complicated.
Yeah. You certainly, if you were doing a condo, you'd want to do a small one. And you'd want to do a condo with, we actually are having conversations right just as we speak with a condo in Saskatoon that's going up now. And we're having, but there's just 8 residents of the condo. And they're actually have built a passive house condo. And some of you will know, will have met one of the people who is involved, because about a year ago, Mike Nemeth was down here speaking. And a few of you were probably at his presentation. This was in the very early days when you were looking at this idea of a co-op. I just wanted to learn a bit more about what we were doing. And Mike gave a little presentation. He's actually Mike Nemeth is chair of this little condo board.
Is this on Temperance Street or a different one?
No, this is out in, it's called Radiance Co-Housing. And it's out in just off 20th Street. It's actually 18th Street and Avenue L in Saskatoon, near Optimus Park. For any of you who know that part of the city. So it's on the west side. And it's fairly close to where Station 20 West is, if a few of you might know that. You know, in the direction of St. Paul's Hospital. Anyway, it's just a little condo that's going up, but it's being built to passive house standards. Really exciting. So at any rate, all I was going to say about this is that, you know, for your first project, I don't recommend you build on a building with multiple tenants. You want to just kind of keep it nice and straightforward and deal with a single building owner and a partnership with them, just for getting started. But we wanted to do this to model that this could be done. And it has been more complicated. There's been about a 3 or 4 month delay between the time we got the panels installed and when we're actually producing revenue from the panels. That's how long it's taken to work out all the administrative things and get the SAS power inspection and all of that. We go on to the next slide.
Are there 4 separate meters there? Or just
4 separate meters. Yeah, that's where it gets more complicated. But you know, part of what we're trying to do here is not just install solar, but model certain things. So that's part of the purpose of the co-op. And these we entered into a long-term lease agreement with this building owner, McGovern Agency. It's a 25-year agreement. And if you're, you know, if you're doing that, you'll want to take some care, obviously, in drawing up the lease agreement to make sure that you're happy with it and that it's going to reflect your needs as well as the needs of the building owner. These are Trina panels that we installed here. The panels that you saw in the installation that we did with the City of Saskatoon were Solar World panels. And we selected these panels because they rank very highly on environmental criteria. And I'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute. But you know, they weren't the cheapest panels, but they were recyclable, and they had lots of good environmental qualities, including transparency in terms of production during the production process for greenhouse gas emissions. And I'll talk a little bit more about some of those environmental criteria in a moment. But you're looking at Trina panels here. Josh, we can go on to the next slide. So, this is the environmental slide, I guess. So, I just wanted to give you an example of some of the things that we sort of looked for in the purchase of panels, and it's costing us a bit to do this. So, and again, it's one of the things that you can do through a co-op model that you might not be able to do as an individual homeowner. I think what most homeowners have been doing, in Saskatoon at least, is looking around for, you know, the cheapest installation they can get with competitive bids from installers, and that's a perfectly reasonable thing to do. But we've been conscious of the fact that, you know, when we get tens of thousands of solar panels up in Saskatchewan, which obviously we hope to do soon, we want them at the end of their lifetime to be recyclable. We want to make sure that there aren't conflict minerals in the panels. That rules out several manufacturers, by the way. We wanted to make sure that the toxic materials in the panels, which there are toxic materials in the panels, but we wanted to minimize those as much as we possibly could. So, you know, that is really important. We wanted to make sure that the panels were being produced in facilities with reasonably good working conditions. So there's a, what, I mean, there's no perfect way of assessing all these things. And what we required from our installers that they demonstrate that this is the case with the panels that they're proposing to install on our rooftops. And the first time we did this, which was on the 220 building, the installers didn't really participate very well. So we made it a requirement the second time around. We basically said, you're going to be evaluated on this and you're going to get scored. When we did the installation with the city, we proposed to the city of Saskatoon and they agreed that 25% of the criteria, 25% of the score for which installation we did was going to be based on environmental criteria. And we had about 12 installers come to the site and only half of them put in bids. I think they were quite intimidated by the environmental criteria. So we basically said to the people who were putting in bids, look, use what's called the North American Solar Scorecard. And if you're doing your own installation at home, you can do this as well. So you can just look up Solar Scorecard on the web. And this is being developed by a group in San Francisco, but it's North American based. And basically they score all the solar panel manufacturers on environmental criteria. So we found that to be a kind of a simple thing that the installers can all readily participate in. So they can either choose panels that rank very highly on the solar scorecard, or they can use panels that don't, but they're penalized in terms of the environmental scoring. On a request for proposal, if they put in panels that don't show well on the scorecard. And there's only about four or five panel manufacturers that are right at the top of the scorecard. So you could, if you wanted to, you could make that part of your request for proposal if you form a co-op. You could also make it criteria for your own home installation if you wanted to. And we also give the installers the ability to come up with alternative criteria. They don't have to use a solar scorecard, but they need to provide us with proof that the panels are of high environmental quality. We've also used what's called RoHS. This is Restriction of Hazardous Substances regulations. It's a European directive that is now becoming more widespread in North America, quite a bit more widespread. The panels you saw in the 220 building, the inverters, the cabling, all of that meets RoHS requirements. And the same with the installation that you saw at on Haskam. We used RoHS there as well. So what that means is that some of your most toxic heavy metals are at very, very low levels in that cabling and electrical material. And so the nice thing is that we're now seeing several of our co-op members, when they do their own installations, they're requiring RoHS and the solar scorecard to be met as well on their own homes. And the installers are saying to us, it's not just you guys we have to deal with on this anymore. You've got this idea going in Saskatoon. We're having to clear the bar. They're laughing because they actually support it. Like, most of the installers support this. They want to do good work. They just haven't seen it being on the radar screen a couple of years ago, and now it is. And they're joking with us. It's not just us asking for it. We can go to the, yes?
How do you spell
the law? R-O-H-S. It's Restriction of Hazardous Substances, and it's a European directive that the European Union brought in few years ago. But it's now being, you know, it's now become much more widely accepted in North America. And several of the panel manufacturers are also starting to adopt it. Restriction of hazardous substances. Correct. ROHS. One of the other things that is nice is that we've basically chosen to use local installers. So the installers know that we're not going out of province to, you know, to look for bids. We're encouraging them to compete, and we're wanting to keep the revenue in the province. So the, when we invest money, it's staying in Saskatchewan. And it's Saskatchewan installers who are basically competing. Yes, sir.
So what do you use for your inverters? Using string inverters or micro inverters?
Both. There's string inverters on the 220 building, the first one we did. The second one we've done and the third one we've done are micro inverters.
What brands?
This is where it would be good to have the head of our installations committee here. I'm sorry that I can't remember that.
Solar Edge is one, I think.
Solar Edge, yes, we have used Solar Edge. Yeah. We use Solar Edge on the Haskamp installation. I don't remember what